So inshallah, we'll start off with the Shaitan Rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So inshallah, we'll do half of the Surah At-Tariq today. So let me do a simple translation first. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Shaitan Rajim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing about two things here, which is the first thing is was-samai, by the sky. Wat-tariqi, and by the morning star. Wama adraka, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts forth a question, then what will inform you and what will make you know? Mat tariqo, what is that at-tariq or the morning star? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, he responds that morning star or that tariq is An-Najmu Thaqib, is a star which is very piercing, sharp, very pointed, very bright in the morning. Then after swearing this and explaining the object of swearing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, In kullu nafsil lamma alaiha hafiz. So I'll do the full translation of this ayat, but then we'll go and break down. The meaning of this ayat is that there is not a single soul, which means every person, every soul, there is a guard after that person. There is someone who is guarding, there is someone who is watching, someone who is looking after that. Okay? So that is the meaning of that ayat. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turns the attention of human being towards his towards the creation of the mankind. And first three ayats are an explanation of the creation, but the main purpose is the ayat number 8, which says that innahu ala raj'ihi laqadir. So the people did not want to believe that there will come a day of judgment, there will be a day of resurrection when people will be brought back to life. They did not want to believe. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He has all the power, Qadir. He has full Qudrat of returning someone who he has already created. So what is such a surprise that if he created someone to begin with out of nothing, then to recreate or to bring him back into the life is very easy compared to the first time creation. So that is the response, but the actual ayat that are being explained here is about the creation of human being. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Fal yanzuril insan. So let man take a look. Let the man see, okay, or pay attention. Mimman khuliqa, of what he has been created. Okay? What is the starting of the creation of mankind? He think about that. Let him think about that, because he was nothing when he was created. Okay? Or he was created for such small thing that the entire creation started from that little thing. And then what is difficult for Allah to recreate the same thing again? The next ayah says, Khuliqa, he was created. The man was created. Mimma'in, from a water, from what ma is literally water, from a liquid. Dafiqin, that comes out. Okay. Yakhruju min baynis sulbi wat taraib. This liquid or this water that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning comes between the backbone and the front ribs. That's this place of the origin. And Allah says that from that little thing, we created this entire human being. So what is the surprise that he cannot recreate on the day of judgment the same person? That is the meaning, the emphasis on this ayat number 8. That people are doubting that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not bring all of us back on one day. Allah says, what is so difficult for him to do that? So that's up to this ayat number 8. So let's go back in the beginning. So the first thing is that first word is a swearing, is an oath. And what is the process or what is the grammar of taking an oath is that this letter vow with a fatha, it has multiple meanings. In one meaning, this is the vow of qasamiya, which means this vow is used to make a qasam, to swear, to take an oath. And how does it work? That if you take a word after that, let's take the word Allahu. Okay? This is the full word Allahu. In a normal way, vow means end. This vow simply means end. Okay? But when it comes with a noun like this, and if we make a change that take the last letter here, the harkat on that, which is Dhamma, and change to a kasra, and we pronounce Wallahi, then this vow is called vow al qasamiya, and the meaning of this word is by Allah, swearing by Allah, taking by Allah. You have a question?
Yes. Vow qasamiya always comes before a noun.
Yes, always. Yes. Okay. Yeah. And then when you pronounce, you will pronounce Wallahi. If you pronounce Wallahu, it will not be qasam anymore. It will be and Allah. But as soon as you change the last letter, harkat from Dhamma to a kasra, then the full word now is Wallahi. Now it is a qasam. Now it is a swearing. Now it is an oath. So that is the way a qasam or a swearing is done in Arabic. Okay? And the meaning of this vow now is by Allah. Okay. Otherwise, the meaning of this vow is end. Okay. So that is how. So now going back to the surah, the word is Sama'un. Sama'un means sky. Sama'un, the full word is sky. And the Arabic full word is Sama'un. You have to completely pronounce the word with the last two dhammas, sound of noon. Sama'un. One more thing also, that whenever there is a Hamza, and before Hamza there is an Alif, then this alif should be pronounced with a mad. Okay. And it happens in three cases. If you have alif, vau, and ya. And before these or after this is hamza, then this alif should be pronounced with a mad. This vau and ya should be pronounced with a mad. This is just a tajweed, pronunciation. So if we are trying to read the Quran correctly, we should pronounce Sama'un, not Sama'un, okay? Because of the combination of Hamza and Alif in this case. So that is one thing. Now, so the word Sama'un means sky, okay? Now if I put Al before that, Al means Da. So the meaning is now the sky. And here, seen is a shamsi letter, it kills the sound of lam. And you have to pronounce seen two times. So it becomes as-sama. And also al changes two dhammas into one on the last letter. So the final word is as-sama'u. As-sama'u. As-sama'u means the sky. Okay? Now if you want to make an oath with this word, you put a vowel before that. vowel qasamiya. And what this vowel will do, as we saw here, this will change this last letter dhamma to a kasra. So now the word is wassama'i. Wassama'i. This means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by the sky. He is taking an oath, he is making a qasam by one of his creation. As-sama, sky is his creation. So only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can swear by his creation. When we have to take an oath, we take oath by Allah. What is oath? What is a qasam? Oath or qasam is that you are making someone a witness of what you're saying. You're saying that such and such is my witness that I'm speaking the truth. That is the oath. That is the qasam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because he created anything and everything, he can take swear by anything. But if I'm making a qasam, if you are making a qasam, you always say by Allah. Wallahi, do not swear by the things, by Quran or by my mother or by this or by that. It's all wrong. Okay, people do this, all those wrong things. So whenever you take an oath, because Allah is the witness. If I say I take oath by this pen will not do anything after I am done. Okay, but if I'm taking oath by Allah, Allah is my witness. So if I do anything against my wrong, Allah will take care of that situation. Okay. So the word is wassama'i, by the sky. That's where the surah starts. Okay? So that's one oath Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making. Then after that, the word that starts with these three letters, Ta, Ra, and Qaf. These are the three root letters. And the word that we create from this is Tariqun. Tariqun is the word. Okay. Now this has a couple meanings. One meaning is something that comes early. And this also is name of a morning star. The star that appears in the sky just before morning. Late night star. There are these stars all over, but some stars show up only when the night is very, very late. So this is the meaning of this, is called morning star. Okay. So this the rotation of the earth is such that there's some stars don't show up after sunset, but they show very, very late at night, just before morning. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by this star. Okay? The morning star. Tariq. Okay? And then what you do, the same thing, you put al before that. Al means da. And when you pronounce al, will remove one dhamma, so it will become tariqu. And in the pronunciation, Ta will kill the sound of Lam. So you will pronounce At-Tariqu. At-Tariqu means the morning star. Okay? So now this word has become At-Tariqu. The morning star. Okay, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to take an oath by this morning star by putting in a vow in the beginning. And this will do the same thing, that last letter will become a kasra, dhamma will become a kasra, just like this thing. So now the full word is wat tariqi. What, and this alif is not pronounced, so this alif changes into a hamzatul wasal, which is small swat. The meaning of that alif now is that do not pronounce this alif. Okay, same thing here. When you pronounce, alif is not pronounced, wallahi is pronounced. So this alif is not pronounced, wat tariqi. Okay, important thing is that is tariqi now. Okay, now when you stop, because that word is before the ayat here, this ayat number one, so the pronunciation will be wat tariq. When you stop, what happens? Whatever is the harkat, in this case it is kasra, this harkat changes into a sukoon. Okay, so the pronunciation will be wat-ta-riq. Okay, it was, see how many transformation this word went through. At the end it is wat-ta-riq. Okay, first one is still was samai because you're not stopping there, but on the second one you are stopping, so you're pronouncing wat-ta-riq. Otherwise, it's wat-tariqi. Okay, and so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by the morning star, by at-tariq.
So the first vowel is for both, and the second vowel is end.
Okay, you can look into this way. You can say that. No, if you want to translate the word, like some translators will say, by the sky and by the tariq. That means you have to have one more vowel in between for and this other vowel, right? Okay. If you translate that way, then the way you will have to do is that you will say this first vowel, which is the vowel qasamiya, is applying to a sama and is also applying to tariq. And this vowel is actually and. So like something is common to both.
Okay. So this vowel in the beginning is for the both words.
Right. And if you want to translate the middle vowel as and. So this is like a bracket and the first vowel is applying to both of them. Okay. Or you can say wasamai by the sky, wattariqi by the morning star. But if you want to say that wasamai wattariqi by the sky and by the morning star, then the first vowel has to be understood as applying to both of them. Okay. So however you want to understand, but the fine point is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by two things. Okay? Now, tariq. People may not know what a tariq is. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا تَارِقَ. He's asking a question. And then he's answering about tariq. So let's look at that one. So the second ayat starts again with waw and ma. Okay, this waw simply means and. There is no qasam here. Okay. Now the word ma. Ma means what? Ma has other meanings also, but here the ma means what? Okay. Then we have these letters, Dal, Ra, and Ya. Okay, these are three letters. So whenever there are three letters, we say they belong to the group of the words called Fa'ala. And the meaning of these three letters is to know. dal, ra, and ya means to know something. Okay. We are going to make a bigger word by adding an alif. Af'ala. Okay. So this is pronounced as af'ala. Okay. This is fa'ala. But this is af'ala. So this will become ad raya. Okay, this same harakat. Okay. Now this ya with the fatha is pronounced as an alif. So the pronunciation will be adra. So the word, the pronunciation will be, and it is written this way, adra. This short alif is alif maqsura, and the pronunciation is adra. What is the meaning of adra? Adra means to inform. Adra means to make someone know. To make known or to inform. Okay? If you are making someone know, you are informing him. Okay? Dara means you know yourself, but adra, you are informing others. That is the meaning of this word, adra. Okay? Also, the name and the word by itself means he informed. The name of the Bab or name of the group also has the meaning of third person past tense.
The word idara is also from direct?
No, not idara. Oh, okay, idrak is a word in Urdu which means comprehension, understanding. You see that from there.
Okay.
So adra means to inform someone. Okay? And adra also means he informed, or third person and the past tense. So the meaning also is he made known or he informed. Okay. Now the word before that is ma. Ma means what? So we don't have to put he here, the meaning will be and what informed. What informed. Okay. And then the letter ka means you. Single person you. Okay. So the word is Vama adraka, and what informed you? Or what will inform you? Or what will tell you? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking or saying that I just took an oath. I said, what tariq? Okay? How will you know what a tariq is? What will tell you what a tariq is? Okay? So that's the question being asked here. Vama adraka, and what will inform you? You is the reader. You is the person who is listening to the Quran. And he hears the word at-tariqu. At-tariqi actually. Wat-tariqi. So Allah says, do you know what I'm saying here? Do you know what I'm using the word at-tariq here for? Do you know about? If you don't know, then I'm going to tell you. Okay? So a question is being asked to the reader. Wama adraka, and what will inform you? Okay. Now also notice that in the writing here, this ma by itself does not have a fatha, mad on it. Okay. Ma means what? But it doesn't, alif does not have a mad on it. But in the Quran, there is a mad on that. Okay? And the reason is same as I mentioned, that if there is alif and there is a hamza after that, this hamza will force to pronounce this with a mad. Okay, and you know that on Adra, this Alif, there is a Hamza. So this little Hamza will force the Ma to be pronounced with a Mad. Wa Ma Adraka. Otherwise, Ma is simple Ma. Okay, so this is how, you know, the Tajweed is also comes out of the Arabic words this way. No, ma is water here when there is a kasra under there. Okay, that's the word ma in here. Okay, but that ma doesn't have a hamza. This ma doesn't have a hamza. So this ma means what? But when you put a hamza and two kasras, ma'in or ma'un, that means water. Okay, so then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa ma adraka. And what will inform you? Okay, so that is the word here, Wama Adraka, and what will inform you? And again, the word is Ma. Ma is what? At-tariq. What is at-tariq? So now this word ma and at-tariqo means what is at-tariq? What is that morning star? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting a question, and what will inform you what that morning star is? Okay, and you notice that this time this ma doesn't have a mad on it, because the next letter does not have hamza. So this time ma should be pronounced short. It's very important, you know, in the recitation we have to be careful about these things. I think 99% people don't distinguish when they read the Quran that where they should stretch, where they should not, and why. Okay.
this tariq has dhamma on it,
right?
And the first one has kasra.
Right.
So why
Okay. Why kasra came there? Because we had to make a qasam there.
Okay.
But here we are not making a qasam.
Okay.
It's just the name. Star, its name. Okay? Because we put a wow and we made a qasam, so tariqu first time changed to tariqi. But here we are not making qasam, we're just saying star. Okay? So mat tariq, what is a tariq? What is the morning star? Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself is answering, what is at-tariq? Okay, by saying that this is a star, noon, jim, and mim are the root letters, and najmun means a star. Najmun means a star. And if I put Al before that, Al will bring, remove A and bring Da, and also it will change these two Dhammas into one. That's what Al does. And the pronunciation again, this Noon that had a Fatha before will kill the sound of Lam, and Noon should be pronounced twice, An-Najmu. So the recitation will be An-Najmu. Noon is being pronounced twice, Lam is not being pronounced. Okay. An-Najmu. An-Najmu means the star. which means Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala saying that At-Tariq is actually a star. Okay, because one of the meanings is someone who comes late. So if you translate that way, you would not know who is coming late. But Allah saying that thing which is coming late at night is actually a star. So he's talking about a star. So that is the reason the word An-Najmu is used. It is a star. The star. Okay. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling one of the quality of this star, which is the next word. And that next word starts with Tha, Kaf and Ba. Okay. And from this word, these three letters is the word Saqibun. Saqibun. What is Saqibun? Something which is very pointed, sharp, piercing. Okay. That is called Saqib. Very pointed, bright, sharp. Okay. It's called Saqibun. Okay. And one of the word is pierce. Used for that. Like when you pierce your ears, you make holes in them very sharply. Okay. So this is a very sharp, bright star. Okay.
What's the meaning of root letters Saqaba? Also pierce?
So this means, like for example, this is verb.
Okay.
The meaning will be to pierce something. Okay. But Saqib means piercing something that is very sharp, pointed, bright. So you can write any of those meanings there. And Al again, Al means the. So it will be the piercing. Saqibu. Okay. Now, after taking those oaths, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making a statement about the human being here, okay? Which is, in kullu nafsil lamma alayha hafiz. Okay? Now, these two words, when the word in comes, and after some words, the word lamma comes, which is both are in the Quran here, lamma, okay? In is translated as not. Yeah, but when it comes with lamma, then it is translated as not. And lamma is translated as but. Okay? If in was by itself, then it means if. But in the sentence, when the word lamma is coming after that, then the meaning of in is not. Okay. Now, so keep these two meanings, and then after that the word is kullu nafsin. Kullu has meaning each. Kullu and nafsin each person or each soul. Kul means everyone or all or each or any. Okay? And nafs is a soul or a person or human being, is the us actually, nafsun. Okay? So these are the meaning of the first four letters, and we'll make a sentence, but let's understand first the separate meanings, okay? Then the word is Allah plus Ha. Okay? Allah means upon, and Ha means it. So when this is written together, Alaiha, Alaiha means upon it. Okay. Okay, so and the last word here is Ha, Fa, and Zo. Okay. The meaning of this is to protect or to guard. Hafaza, Hafa and Za, Zwa, this means to guard something, to protect something. So why do we call a person who memorizes the Quran as a Hafiz the Quran? He is protecting the Quran, that even if you take all the hard copies, the Quran is going to remain there. So he's guarding, he's protecting the Quran. So that is the meaning of Hafa and Zwa. Okay? So Hafizun, the literal meaning of the word Hafizun, is a guard or a protector. So that's the meaning of Hafizun. When you stop, you can say Hafiz, but the word is Hafizun. So now combine these meanings and see what comes out. So I'm going to write down some extra words. Okay. It is not, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, it is not, but each soul or is a person, upon that person is a guard, is a protector. And there are many meanings of that, that we are not free. Allah is guarding us or protecting us, okay, or watching us. So for every soul, every person that is here in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is guarding him, is protecting him, is watching him. He is not free. Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is not, but every soul has a guard around or upon him, someone who's watching him constantly. Okay? So that is what the meaning is, that in kullu, it is not that on any soul, but there is a guard. Okay? So that is the meaning of the ayat, the whole sentence. You have to arrange the words properly for translation. So okay, it is not, but each person or each soul, upon that is a guard, is a hafiz, is a watcher. Okay? So that is the meaning. It is not any person, but upon him is a guard. Is a guard. Okay. So that means everyone has someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching him. He's a guard upon. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us about our creation. Okay? So the ayat starts with فَلْيَنْزُرِ الْإِنسَانُ مِمَّ خُلِقْ. Let's look at that one. فَا and a lamb are two, have two different meanings. We'll come to them. But the root letters are Noon and Zwa and Ra. Nazara. Nazara means to see. We know that Nazar is the vision which we see with that all the time. So Nazara means to see something. Okay? And from this, if you put a Ya in the beginning and make the word Yanzuru, Yanzuru means he sees. Yanzuru, when you put a Ya in the beginning, it becomes the present tense and third person grammar. Yanzuru means he sees. Okay? Now, if I, so I'm going to write down he sees here. Okay? And if I put the word insan after that, which is al-insanu, the man. Al-insanu means the man. Okay. Now, when I put in proper noun here or proper name, then I don't have to translate he here. Okay, so this is actually he sees, present tense. Okay, so when I put here the man, then I don't have to translate this. The meaning will be the man sees. Yanzurul insano, the man sees. That's the, so far the meaning of these two words. Okay. Yanzurul insano. Now there are two more letters before this thing. What are they going to do, these two letters? First one is simple. It means so. Okay, first letter fa means so. But this letter lam is going to do some change in the meaning. Okay, and how does it change? So when you put a lam before that, with a fatha, how it is going to change the meaning in Arabic? It does two things. First, it takes this last letter and changes into a sukoon. Okay? And then it brings the meaning let or should. So the meaning is let man see, or he should, man should see. Okay, so this lam brings the meaning of, in English, like you are saying, let him see this, let him do it. Okay, so fa means then, and it will be fal yanzur, let the man see. Or the man should see. فَلْيَنْزُرْ الْإِنسَانُ, so let the man see. That's the meaning of this lam, brings the meaning of, which means without lam, the meaning was he is seeing something, man is seeing something. But now, by this combination, you're saying, let him find out, let him see, allow him to see. Okay? So that is the meaning of falyanzuril insan. Okay? So this is let the man see. Let the man see. Okay. Falyanzuril. So, fa means so. So I prefer so before that. So the let. So let the man see. Okay.
So what's the meaning of only lamb?
lamb has many meanings. But in this case, with this combination, lamb has a meaning of lamb et taqid also, emphasizing something. Lam also means, brings the meaning of ta'ke, so that. But in this formation, that if you put a lam and you change the last letter to a dhamma to a sukoon on the present tense, then the meaning, instead of present tense, it becomes let. Let him see, let him do, let him go. If you want to bring that, then you bring the fa and lam together and change the last to a last letter, dhamma to a sukoon, and pronounce falyanzur. Okay? So let the man see. Okay? Then the word is mimman. Min and so mimma. Min and ma. Of what? Okay, these two together are written as mimma. Noon is pronounced as mim. When noon and mim come together, then this noon is pronounced as mim. Mimma. Mimma means of what? So let man see of what? Let men see of what? So that's the meaning so far. Okay. Now, let's look at a rule here. You have these three letters. Fa'ala. Fa'ala means to do. Okay? If you combine these three letters and you put a fataha, fa'ala, this means he did. He did. Now, if I make one change here, a small change, keep the same three letters and keep this fataha there, but if I change these two this way, instead of fataha I put a dhamma, instead of this fataha I put a kasra. The word is fa'ila. What is meaning of the fa'ila? Means was done. In English, it's called active and passive. He did and something was done to him. Qatala, he killed. Qutila, he was killed. Okay, so that is, you go between active and passive voices in English. In Arabic, you just change these two letters. Harakat on them. So you pronounce fa'ala, somebody did something. You pronounce fa'ila, something was done to that person. He did not do himself anything, but something was done to him. Okay? So if you apply this rule, this is halaqa. He created. He created. Okay? If you make a change here, just like those two letters, Khuliqa, he was created. Okay, so that's the word in the Quran. Let men see of what he was created, of what thing he has been made of. Okay, he was created. Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking the reader, let the man see what he was created of. What he was created with or of. Okay. Then the next ayat starts with the same one. He was created. Okay, so the same words. Khuliqa. He was created. Okay. Then are two words. Min. Min means from. Min means from. And the next word is ma'in. Actually, the word is ma'un. Ma'un. Ma'un means water or liquid. Ma'un is the original word. Ma'un means some liquid or some water. Okay. Also, this min is a harf jar. When you combine these, then these two dhammas will change to two kasras, and pronunciation will be min ma'in. Also, meme and noon, when they come together, this noon is pronounced as a meme. Okay, so what will happen here? In pronunciation, this will become mim and this will become in. Mimma in. Okay, also there is a hamza here and there is an alif here. So you will have to pronounce this alif with a long bath. So see that just by combining these two small words, how many changes took place? Originally this was min and this was ma'un. But as soon as you combine, this becomes mim, this becomes ma'in. Okay? The meaning in English remains same. But in Arabic, all those changes have to be incorporated. So, khuliqa, he was created min ma'in, from a water or from a liquid. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, he was created from a liquid. Okay. Then the next word starts with these three letters, dal, fa, and qaf. Okay. The meaning of this is to come out. To come out. Okay. So, and the word, the noun from is dafiqun. Which means coming out. Okay. So, the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he was created from a water or from a liquid that comes out of the human body. Okay. Who gushes out, who comes out fast from the human body. Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the basic element of the creation. Okay. And in the Quran, other places it's called nutfa. Okay. So this water that comes out, which is of no value, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that he was created by that. The man, let the man think. What he was created with just a drop of water which comes out. Such a small thing, but look after the creation how different he became, how great personality he has now. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go back and think about the beginning of the creation. How were you? What were you before you were created? So that's what being reminded here. So this is coming out or gushing out. Coming out with force. That is what da'afirun is. Okay. Now, the next word is yakhruju. So yakhruju start with these letters, kharaja. Kharaja means also to come out. Kharaja, someone goes out or someone comes out, is kharaja. Okay. And when you put a ya in the beginning, yakhruju, it comes out. It's a present tense. It comes out. Yakhruju, it comes out. And this, it is pointing to the water again. Ma. Okay. So this water comes out. Okay. So it comes out. Now the next two words, mim bain, both words mean between. This mim bain means in between. Okay. Now there are two words. One is salbun and the other one is taraibun. Salbun is our backbone. That backbone that we have here is called salbun. Okay. And these ribs that we have here, they're called taraib. So these are ribs. Okay. And when you put al here, it becomes the ribs and the backbone. Al and al.
Is backbone or only back?
No,
back.
Bones.
Backbone?
Just this long bone which is running from here, yeah. Spinal cord. Okay. There's a lot of research on that, and I did some work on Tafhimul Quran and I added few things in there. The body which starts from in backbone, it starts from the back of the head, and it's a long bone that goes all the way here. And all these ribs, we have two kinds of ribs here in the front and back. You know, the ribs where our whole chest organs are enclosed. So, and they are connected. The rib connects to the backbone. Physically, their bones are connected together, okay? In between is the source where this liquid is generated. This nutfa is generated there, okay? So that is what it is saying. Yakhrujo, it comes out somewhere. There is a generation between the backbone and the ribs here. That is what it is saying. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created from a water or a liquid, and that liquid comes out from between the bones, rib bones and the back bones. So that's what it is saying, and this is actually proven by the modern science. Until now it was not known the source of this liquid. It's modern science has discovered, the medical science, that what is the source, the starting point of this liquid, this water that's being mentioned here. Okay, so that is min baini, between the backbone and the ribs. Okay, vav means and the ribs. Okay, the tribe is a plural, ribs, and sulb is one, because backbone is only one. So between the backbone and the ribs, this is the origin where this ma'un, this water, descends to. Okay, so that is what the creation of the human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning, that it is such a small thing that the creation is beginning from, and then it comes out of the human body, but its source of creation or source of generation is between the backbone and the ribs. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning the creation of the human being, the starting point of the human being. Okay, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the whole purpose of these three ayats is saying that if you don't want to believe that one day we will raise you again, we will bring you back to life again, why it is so difficult for us? You were created from nothing. You do exist now, so can we make you the same way as we made you before? It's possible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the mushrikeen were not believing that they will be raised one day on the day of judgment. So that is what this ayat is. Innahu ala raj'ihi laqadir. He has qudrat, he has power, qadir, to raj'i, to return you back to the human being. After you are dead, after you have gone, he'll bring you back. So what is so difficult to believe? Because first time we created you were not even there, with such a small thing that had no value for you. Okay, we created and we turned you into a full human being, and then when you die, don't you think that you can be made again? So this is what is this ayat is saying. You have a question?
Tara, the singular form is Tara.
Yeah, Tarabun.
Is it the same Tara like dust?
No, that is Turab. That is dust, though. That's a different word. Yeah, that is a totally different word. Yeah. That is Turab, means dust. Okay, this is Taraib, which means the ribs. Okay. Now, so let's finish the ayat. Innahu, inna means indeed. This word is made of inna, surely, and who means him, and he is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here. He is pointing to Allah. Indeed he, surely he. Okay, that's the meaning of innahu. Surely he means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Then the word is Ra, Jim, and Ayn. Raja. And so this means is to return. When we say Rajiun, we return to Allah. Okay, so Raja'a means to go back, to return. And the noun from this is Raj'un. Raj'un means returning. Raj'un means return or returning. Okay? And who means him or he, And this is nafs or person. So when you combine this, this will be Raj-Ohu. So Raj-Un and Hu will be combined as Raj-Ohu. Will be written this way, Raj-Ohu. His return, the return of the man, return back to the life on the day of judgment. That is Raj-Ohu. Okay, now put Allah before that. Allah means upon. Okay. Allah means upon, and Allah is a harf jar, so Allah will change this to a kasra, Raj-i, and for pronunciation we will pronounce this he also, so it will be ala Raj-ihi, upon his return. His here is the man. Okay, so Allah upon his return, or means to return him, is Qadir. Okay, so Qadir is from these letters Qaf, Dal and Ra. Qadara, it means to have power. Qudrat. Qadara means to have power. And the noun from doer is Qadirun. Qadirun means powerful. The one who has power is called Qadirun. Okay. Full word Qadirun. Okay. And the lam before that is called Lam-e-Taqeed. Lam-e-Taqeed. And this means surely. Okay. So indeed, surely he, means surely the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has surely the full power, or is powerful upon returning him back. It means he's raising them again. On the day of judgment, Allah has full power to do that. That should not be a surprise. Then why would he? For he may not be able to create them again. If he created first time, then he has the full authority and full power to recreate him. Okay? So that's what being said after that many explanations, that this is easy for Allah. Okay? Upon returning him. Powerful, has full power and full authority to return him. Okay. So this is half of the surah of Surah At-Tariq. So inshallah we'll continue. So inshallah we'll start. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So we'll do the second part of Surah At-Tariq today inshallah. And so we'll do a simple translation first. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, mentions about in the ayat number 9, something about the day of judgment, the day of Akhirah. And the word for that is used, Yawma, that day. The day when the judgment will be established. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says all the secrets will be out that day. And فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ قُوَّةٍ وَلَا نَاصِرٍ. And for us, any person or anyone, there will be no power that he will have or no helper that will be there for him. Okay. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing again here by the sky. وَالسَّمَاءِ, and by the sky, ذَاتِ الرَّجْعِ, the one that returns. And here it returns the rain, it brings down the rain. So there is the swearing about the rain. Okay. Then another swearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing, is taking another oath, wal ardi, and swearing by the earth, dhatir sad'i, and sad'i is the thing that some splits. So when the vegetation comes out of the ground splits. So that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing about that also. And after swearing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, innahu, indeed this, laqawlun, is a statement. And it's about the Quran, that this is a statement, this is a qawl. Faslun, which is very decisive statement. Faslun is from faisla, decision making. So this statement, this word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, is a very, very decisive statement and word. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says one more time, وَمَا هُوَ, and this is not, again about the Quran, بِالْحَزْل, something that can be used to amusement or for the enjoyment. This is a very definite kalam from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about in the next ayat, those people who plot against the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, innahum yakiduna, indeed those people are plotting, kaidan, a plot. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that in response, wa akidu, and I am plotting something, I am planning something, a kaidan, a plot against them. Okay, so they will not succeed because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's plan or plot is much powerful than what they think about doing. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing here Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and whoever is reading the Quran in the last ayat, فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ, so give them, give some respite, give some time to the disbelievers, to the kafirin. أَمْهِلْهُمْ رُوَيْدَ, and leave them alone for a short while, because the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come and they will be failing in their planning and plots which they are doing against the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the basically the simple translation of the ayats of the Quran. So going back to the beginning, the first ayat starts with the word yawma. Yawma here just simple means a day. But this is a day from the context, the day of judgment, the day of Akhirah, Yawmul Akhirah. So this is just a day. Okay. And the next two words, we'll just break it down. So the next word, the word after that will take first, Sin, Ra and Ra. These are the root letters. And Sirrum is the word from these. Two ras are written with the shabda, sirrun. Sirrun means secret. The word sirrun means a secret of something, about something. Okay? And its plural is sarayun. Sarayun means the secrets. So sirrun is one secret and sara'irun are many, many secrets. Okay? Then if you put al before that, Al means the secrets. And when we put al, these two last them must change into one. Okay. And in the recitation, sin being a shamsi letter kills the sound of lam. So it is pronounced as as-sara-iru. As-sara-iru means the secrets. Now these are the secrets that all of us are carrying in our hearts and hiding things from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and whatever doing in this world which don't come out, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about those secrets that all the human beings carry within themselves. So what will happen to those secrets on the day of judgment? That is the word turbula. So let's look at that. So root letters are ba, lam, and ya. Okay. This means something to come out. Okay. So simple meaning is that to be out. And there are few other meanings of this, but here the meaning will be something is going to be out. And tubula, literally the meaning is that she, which is the feminine, will be out. Okay. Now the word after this is as-sarair. So we don't have to translate this letter word she, because this is a group, and for a group we use the grammar of feminine. So the meaning will be the secrets will be out. On that day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Tubula sara'iru. On that day, all the secrets will be out and they will be looked into that, and they will be judged accordingly. So what people had in their hearts and in their minds. Okay. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Yawma, that day, Tubula sara'iru, the secrets will be out. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that on that day when people will be standing for the accountability, for the judgment, everyone will be responsible for himself. Okay? So the words are for that. Famalahu. Let's look at those words. So the first one is fa. Fa means so or then. Ma means not. Okay. And la and who. La means he for, and who means him. Okay. And him is the man. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Fama lahu, then for him is not. At that time, for a man or for a person, there is not any. Okay, what is that not? Let's look at the words after that. The word is af, vav, and ya. These are the root letters. And this means to be strong or to have power, quwwat, to have power. Or to be powerful. Qawi is someone who is very powerful. The one that who has quwwat. Okay. And the actual the noun from this is quwwatun. Quwwatun means power. And when we stop we say quwwat. But the full word is quwwatun. Quwwatun means power. Now, the word before that is min. Min has several meanings, but the meaning here is any. And min is a harfajar, and what harfajar does, it looks at the last two dhammas and changes it to two kasras. So this the pronunciation becomes min quwwatin. Okay, min quwwatin means any power. So on that day, there is no power for them. For him, there is no power. For a person has absolutely no authority, no power. So that's the meaning. Fama lahu. So not for him, for a person, min quwwatin, any power or any authority. Okay, so that's what the words are so far. Okay. And then in the pronunciation, there's a vowel after that. So you pronounce quwwatum instead of quwwatum. Tin quwwatim. Okay. And then wa and la. La means not. Okay. So the meaning so far is that. So not for him any power. So a person will not be able to have any authority or any power on that day. Okay. And the next word after that is wala nasir. Okay. So wow means end and la means not. Okay. And the word after that is, it starts with these three letters, Noon, Swad, and Ra. Nasara. Nasara means to help, like Nusrat or helping. So this means to help. Okay. And if we put an alif between the first and the second letters, it will become Nasirun. Nasirun or Nasir when we stop. Means helper. So a person on that day will have no quwwat, no power, and he will have no one who can help him, no helper for him. Okay? So Nasirun means helper. So after making these two statements, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is again taking oath twice before making a second statement. So what is the purpose of an oath? Oath is done when you want to say something and you want to make sure that other person believes that. There is surety in there is authority in there. So that is the reason oath is taken or a qasam is done. Okay. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next two ayats is swearing one time by the sky, was samai, and the second time by the earth, wal ardi. Okay. So the word starts with samaun. Samaun is the original word. Samaun means sky. Sama'un is the original word. It means sky. Okay. Now, if you put al before that, okay, al means the sky. Okay. Al, and al will remove two dhammas and change into one. And in the pronunciation, seen will be pronounced twice. Asr lam will not be pronounced, so it will become asmau. Again, there is a hamza and there is an alif. So whenever these two come, then alif should be with a matn. In the tajweed, when hamza and alif come in this combination, then alif should be stretched. Okay. So the word is as-sama'u. The final word here is as-sama'u. As-sama'u means the sky. As-sama'u, the matter. Okay. Now we are going to put a vowel before that. This is called vowel qasamiya. This is used to take an oath. Okay. So what this vowel qasamiya does? It changes this to a kasra. So the word becomes wassama'i, by the sky. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking an oath by the sky. Okay. Wassama'i. So keep in mind that if we did not change the last letter here, Dhamma, and left the Dhamma there, then the meaning will be and the sky. It will not be a qasam, it will not be an oath. For the oath to happen, this last dhamma has to change into a kasra. And the pronunciation should be wassama'i now. Okay, that's important. Because even if in the recitation we did not pronounce it correctly, when we are reading the Quran, meaning will change. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is here taking an oath by the sky. By this guy. Now there are two words after that. What is the purpose of this qasam? Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning two words after that. First one is zati. Zati means which. That which. Okay. And the next word is starts with these three letters, Ra, Jim, and Ayn. Raja'a. Raja'a means to return. When we say Raji'un, we return. That is the root letters, Ra, Jim, and Ayn. Raja'a. Okay, so if we combine these and make the word which is called noun, Raj'un. Raj'un means returning. Raj'un means returning. Then again we do the same thing, put an al, the returning, okay, and again al will remove one dhamma and it will be pronounced as ar-raj-u. And this zati will change this to a kasra. Zatir Raji. Now what's the meaning of Zatir Raji? The one or the which is going to return. What does it return? It returns the rain. It is implied here that this is sending down the rain. So like water goes up from earth and the sky and then it sends back down. So you can also translate sending down the rain or returning the rain. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by this quality of the sky that it sends the rain back down to the earth. Okay, wasamai, by the sky, the tirraji, the one which is returning the rain. So that is what the meaning is, that which returns the rain. Returning rain. Wasamai, and by the sky, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking by the sky that is returning the rain. Okay. So that is one statement from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. After that, a second qasam and second swearing is done by the earth. And that is something else is happening on the earth. So let's look at that one. Again, the first word is zati. Okay. Okay, for the, and before that is the ardun. Ardun means earth. Ardun means earth. And then you do the same thing, you put al before that. Al means the. Okay. So this will be pronounced al ardu, because two dhammas will become one. Al ardu means the earth. Written as one, al ardu, the earth. Okay, al ardu is the earth. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using this word for the oath. So you put a vow, which is a vow of qasamiya, and to make it the qasam, last letter has to change to a kasra, and this will be by the earth. Wal ardi, by the earth. That's the word in the Quran. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by the earth. Wal ardi, by the earth. Okay. Then after that is the word swad, dal, and ayn. Swada. Okay. This means to split. Split. Okay. Or to crack and open. Okay. So what happens? Okay, so the word is sadun. Sadun, noun, which means splitting. Sad'un means something that splits and cracks or opens. So what happens when a plant or a tree or a seed comes out of the ground? It splits a little bit. Okay, so that is this splitting means here. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by saying wal ardi, taking oath by the ground or by the earth, zati sad'i, the one that splits open, that cracks and opens, and the vegetation starts coming out. Okay? So the sama is, it sends the rain down, and when the rainwater goes in and the seed is there, it starts coming out, it splits the earth, it breaks the earth. So that is the second part of the swearing. Val ardi, and by the earth, dhati sadai, the one that splits open, which splits and becomes cracked and open. So that is the second custom, second oath. Now, after making these two oaths, after swearing two times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making a statement, very short statement, which is only innahu laqawlun fasl. So anything which is said after qasam is a very, very important thing. Okay, so after these two statements, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making a statement after these two qasams, and which is innahu laqawlun faslun. So let's look at these words. Okay, so the first word is made of two parts. Inna means surely. Inna means surely. Then the word after that is who. Whom is it? Okay. And this it is pointing to Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that indeed, surely, certainly this Quran. Okay. Then the word after that is starts with qaf, waw, and lam. This means to say. Okay. And the noun is qawlun. Qawlun means a saying or a statement. Qawl or qawlun means a statement or just saying. Okay. Or a statement. Okay. Then we are going to put a letter before that, lam with a fatha. Okay. This is called lam e taqeed. It emphasizes, so it also means indeed or surely. So what's being said? Surely this Quran is surely a statement. This Quran is definitely surely a statement or is a saying. Okay. But what kind of a statement it is? That's the next word which is defining. What kind of a statement is it? Okay. Which is the word is fa, swad, and lam. Fasala. And the word faisla or judgment, faisla kun, is from this. The one that is very decisive. The statement that is a very decision making. So faslun means something that makes a big decision, decisive. Decision making. So this Quran is a word which is going to decide completely what is right and what is wrong. It's a very clearly decision making statement that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down, separating the right and the wrong, making a judgment, making a decision about everything. So that is what this statement is being. Innahu laqawlun faslun. So this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is emphasizing so much. First of all, before making this statement, he is swearing two times. And Allah does not need to swear, because whatever he says is a definite thing. So even that what he says is a definite thing, he is taking an oath, he is swearing. Then when the statement starts, he uses the surety by inna and by la. It's more emphasis, more definite, surety, certainty in the statement. And then this Quran is a decisive statement. The Quran is something that is going to make a decision, what's wrong, what's right. Okay, so that is innahu laqawlun fasl. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that indeed it, or surely this is sure statement. Sure saying. And what is that sure saying? Is that it is a decision making, decisive. Faslun, very much decisive. Something that makes a decision between what is right and what is wrong. Okay, so that is the statement, or this is the word of Quran which is being said with so much emphasis. Okay. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is adding one more in there by saying wama huwa bil hazl. Let's look at that one. Wa means and, ma means not. Okay. Hova means it again. Hova means it. And this is again pointing to the Quran. And this is not. This time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, this is not. Wama hova, and this is not. Okay. What is it not? The word is starts with ha, za, and lam. Hazala. Hazala means to amuse or to enjoy. Like when we go to the amusement park, that's for playing and enjoying and all those things. So amuse means to have fun, to play around. Okay. Hazala. And the noun from this is hazlun. Hazlun. Hazlun means enjoyment or amusement. Something which is used to play around. Okay. And then again the same thing, you put a al before that. The amusement. Something which is used to play around for fun. Okay. Having good time, enjoyment. Okay, that's amusement. And when you put al, these two dhammas change into one. And the word is al-hazlu, the amusement, the enjoyment. Okay. Then we are going to put a letter B. B means of or with. Or with. And B is a harfijar. And what harfijar does, on the next word, it changes this dhamma to a kasra. So now the full word is bil hazli. That's the word in the Quran. Bil hazli means something of enjoyment. But Allah says that it is not. Wama huwa, this is not something that you play around with. This is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This Quran is the decision making, a decisive statement, and it is not something that you should just play around with that. You take it lightly. Okay? You think that the ayat are for just fun. Quran, ayat of the Quran are just for fun or playing around or having good time. Allah subhanahu says that this is a decisive decision making, and this is not a something that you want to play around with. Okay, so that is wama huwa bil hazl. Okay. And not it of enjoyment or amusement. That's something you want to play around with, have fun with, or just take it lightly, or don't take it seriously, or do whatever you want to do with it. It's not that. It is the kalam, it's the qawl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's a very decisive statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, after that, in the next ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the kuffar, the disbelievers. Okay, and what they do when they hear the Quran, they try to make their own plans. They make their own plotting how to defeat or how to undervalue the Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about innahum yakiduna. Okay. So first, let's look at these words, kaf, ya, and dal. Okay. These three letters means to plot something. To make a plot, to do some planning. Okay. Kai, kaf, ya, and dal means a plot. Okay. To do a plot. So first thing is, if I combine kaidun, kaidun means plot. Plot or plan something. Okay. That is kaidun. Okay. The noun is made with two dhammas at the end. Kaidun means a plot. Okay, planning of do something. Okay. Now again, if we have these three letters, fa, an, and lam, which means to do, and if we add some grammar here and make it yafaluna, by put a ya in the beginning and guna at the end, yafaluna. This means they do. Okay. So this brings the meaning of yaf'aluna, third person plural, which is they, and present tense wuna. Okay, yaf'aluna. Okay. So if we do this grammar, then if we apply on these three letters, this will be yakiduna. Yakiduna means they plot, or they are plotting, or they are planning. Okay, so that is the word or the meaning of yakiduna. They are planning or they are plotting. Okay, now before that is that two words, inna. Inna we just learned. Inna means surely, and hum means they. These are the Allah Subhanahu wa Taala is talking about his believers, kuffar. What are they doing? Surely, and whom means they? Surely they. Okay. Yakiduna, they plot. Okay. after that is kaidun. Kaidun means a planning or a plot or a chal. But because this is a noun and when noun comes after the verb, last two dhammas change into last two fatha. So this becomes kaidun instead of kaidun. Okay? And the meaning is plot. So Allah says that definitely they are plotting a plot. They are planning something. Okay? Their purpose is to defeat the Quran. Okay? So they are doing their own planning. The kuffar get together and they do their own plotting. They do their own planning how to reject, how to keep the people from coming towards the Quran. Okay? So that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that there are people, these people, their purpose is that they are planning, they are plotting a plot, okay, a plan of their own, that how to defeat the Quran. Okay? So that is what this ayat says. Okay? So they, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they are doing this thing, but I am also doing something. Okay? And also, so here, again, if you go back to these three letters, fa'ala, and if I put in alif in the beginning, and make the grammar af'alu. Af'alu is the grammar of I do. Af'alu, if you put an alif in the beginning, and pronounce as af'alu, this means I do. Okay? So kaf, ya, and da means to plot. If I put an alif here, it will become I plot. That's the word in the Quran in the next ayat. Wa means and, akidu, I am planning too. Allah says, I am also planning something. I am also plotting something. Which means they will be defeated. My plot is strong. Okay? So that is what the ayat says, wa akidu and I plot. And again, same word, kaidan, plot. So they are planning something and I am planning something. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling that whatever they are planning, this is that plan, their plan, but I am also planning something. And what is Allah's plan? That they will be defeated in their plot, in their plan. Okay? So now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that both sides are doing some planning. Okay? They are doing something and I am doing something. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next and the last ayat instructs Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, give them some time and leave them alone. I'll take care of them. So that's the next ayat. Okay. So the first one is Meem, Ha, and Lam. These are the root letters. Okay. These are three letters, so they belong to the group of the words we call fa'ala, fa, ayn, and lam. Okay. Now I'm going to go to the next group, which is called fa'ala, where you put a shut down the middle letter. Okay. So this becomes mahala, meem, shut down the middle letter, and lam. Okay, the word that we commonly know is muhlat. Giving some time, giving a respite. Okay, so that is the meaning of this word. Mahala is to give some time. Muhlat. Okay, so this is to give respite. That is the English word for that. What to respond? So, Fa, the letter, means so. Mahil is this. So when you write down together, Mahil, this means give time. Or give some break, give them mohlat. Okay? So those who are plotting, let them plot. Because I am plotting here. So, O Prophet, you don't have to do anything. Just give them some time. Okay, so that is famahil. So give them some mohlat. Give them some time. That is the first word, famahil. Okay, and because the word after that is al kafirina, that means give mohlat to the kafirin. Instead of they, give them. Okay, so famahil lil kafirina. So give a break or a time or some respite or mohlat to disbelievers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and obviously the companions with him, that these kuffar are plotting something. Let them plot. Give them time. I am also doing a plotting against them. Okay, and they will see very soon. So that is the meaning so far. Then after that is again the same three letters are being used, but this time a different group of Bab is being used, which is Af Allah. If you put an Alif in the beginning, this will become Alif, Mim, Ha and Lam. Amhala. This is a different word, even though it comes from the same three root letters. And Amhala means to leave. Mahala means to give some respite, some time, mohlat. But Amhala means to leave somebody. Amhala. So Amhil, Amhil means leave. It's a command, it's an order by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the believing Muslims, leave. And after that is whom. Whom means them. Leave them. Leave the kuffar. Okay. Give some mohlat, give them some time, and just don't argue with them, don't fight with them, just leave them alone. Okay? So amhilhum means leave them. Now the last word, Ruwaida. Ruwaida means a short while. For a short time. A short while. Leave them a short while. And it is known from the history that all those who opposed the message, the Prophet, the Quran, they all were wiped out. They all were defeated. Okay? They all were given some time. If they wanted to come back or accept the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fine. If not, Allah said that I was plotting something against them, against their plot, and they were defeated. Okay? So that is the end of this ayat. Okay. So inshallah, we'll stop at this point.